So last time we stopped on the GRI 3, a general rule of interpretation 3. We are discussing the what I like to refer to as constitution of the harmonized tariff schedule, which defines the set of principles that help you read the text, that help you interpret the text and apply the text to a particular set of facts. On the customs exam, it's very imperative to understand the general rules of interpretation, because those rules will be a guiding point for classification questions. And questions on classification, on harmonized tariff schedule, always come up on the exam. They are the major point of the major part of the exam, and you may not pass without knowing classification. So we're talking about general rule of interpretation 3. Prior to talking, getting to 3, we discussed the general rule of interpretation 1, general rule of interpretation 2a and 2b. And we put them in a context where of certain structure. First of all, within the structure, we know that there are six general rules of interpretation, and those rules are applicable in an increasing order. So you start with 1, you go to 2, you go to 3, you go to 4, etc., etc. But in reality, even though you have to use that increasing order, you sometimes have to jump. And when you do the jumping, you most likely will be faced with the three major provisions which you will have to be applying throughout your exam studies and on the exam itself. And this is GRI 1, GRI 3, and GRI 6. Those are the heavy hitters. So when we talked about 1, we established, notwithstanding this long archaic text, that three things matter. And those things include section notes, chapter notes, and terms of the heading. So those, and of course chapter notes, as we covered the introduction to the HTSUS, we established the chapter notes can include additional US notes, they can include they can include heading notes, they can include subheading notes, so they have their own breakdown in the hierarchy. Section notes include are binding on all chapters within a section, and heading terms is really the starting point of the analysis, because they provide the most specific description of what's covered and what's not covered. So whenever we see the question on the customs broker exam and we see the five answer choices which give you various headings, so you have one 4411, 9503, etc., etc., it's a good idea to start with the terms of the heading, because one, they're legally binding, two, they are specific, and three, is not always, but very often you may be able to, just looking at the terms of the heading, derive the right answer without even going to the section and chapter notes, which is extremely important, because the customs broker exam is really about time management and being able to quickly answer the questions that we need. So in between, we focused a little bit on GRI 2, and GRI 2 is really like a transit point, because it deals with the articles which were incomplete or unfinished. They come in, they are really, you have a marker, which is really incomplete marker because, for example, it is missing a cap. Or sometimes you have three articles disassembled or unassembled. So we talked about bicycle parts, for example, which come in separately simply because it was the convenient way to transport, not because it is necessarily required, but it was more cost effective to do it that way. So whatever the reasons are, so long as the article once assembled represents the whole, and the GRI, a general rule of interpretation too, allows us to put the article in allows us to assign the HTS number as to the complete article, even though it's assembled article, I'm sorry, even though it's disassembled. Complete article when versus incomplete, of course, we mentioned we first came across the essential character rule. And essential character rule is really the rule of thumb. You look at something, and that something looks like a complete article. Yes, it's a marker, but the marker is missing a cap. But it looks essentially like a complete marker. It can mark, it can write. So the really minor component, the cap, is missing. So what? Essentially, it's a marker, so we classify it as a marker. As opposed to us having only the cap, if we have only the cap without a marker, it's really the minor component. It does not provide essential character for the whole marker itself. In case of another peculiarity that we mentioned in case of unassembled, disassembled, was the notion of extra components, or sometimes called spare parts. So if you have the unassembled marker coming in with two caps in it, right? We classify this as a part, or as a, whatever provision is provided for the marker parts, and we classify something as a marker. This is an extra component. It is not necessary for the marker to be assembled, to be complete. So there will be two HTSUS numbers. Then we went to the general rule of interpretation B, and we discussed that in the context of booms, oil booms, where you have a mixed good or a combined product which has various components to it, but it is essentially classifiable, not classifiable in two or more headings, because if you classify it in two or more headings, you have to go to analysis of general rule 3, A through C. Now, we also noted that general rule 2B is not very often used because most of the mixed goods can be classifiable in two or more headings, so GRI 3 would automatically apply. As we notice, it's a big one. Nevertheless, it is helpful to be mindful of GRI 2B because it refers to mixed products, mixtures, combined products that are not classifiable in two or more headings. Now, this now brings us to general rule of interpretation 3. And general rule of interpretation 3 has really three components to it. It has A, B, and C. And each component have their own unique peculiarities, which we shall discuss. But we always, as we must, we start with the introductory text. And that introductory text essentially says the following. Let me make it a little bigger. Okay, so here is a snippet of the GRI 3, and GRI 3 says when 2B requires you so, and remember the 2B says that you must go to 3 if it's classifiable in two more headings, or any other reason, meaning there may be many reasons, it's broad, but generally speaking, the goods before you start applying GRI 3 must be classifiable under two or more headings. So there must be possibility of two or more numbers to be applicable. For example, you have a ladder, and the ladder is made out of metal and made out of plastic. 50-50. Is it article of plastic or article of metal? Both chapters for plastic, chapter 39, and chapter for metal, for example, steel, chapter 73, provide for ladders. And where do you go? Is a product classifiable under two or more headings? Or do we even need to talk about GRI? So those are the issues that we need to be mindful of. It's very important to note that GRI 3 is more rare on a customs broker exam because usually GRI 1 takes care of many situations. So you going back to the ladder example, where you have articles of plastics versus articles of metal. Yes, you're looking at the headings. There it is possible to for the item to be classifiable under two or more headings. However, when you remember the GRI 1 has terms of the headings as legally binding component, but it also has the chapter notes and the section notes. So there are two more legally binding components. And when you go to those chapter notes and section notes, they will usually clear out the uncertainty which was created by applicability of two more headings. Again, remember, that's the general rule of interpretation one. And because of that, you really never have a need to go to three. And the section notes and heading notes, they are they're being revised also. So sometimes if you use the old HTSUS, it may be helpful if you do the update for the section notes, chapter notes. And how would you know that? Well, what you do if you're using the old HTS is you simply go to the change of record, which is right here at the very beginning, and you can kind of see that it starts by the change if to general notes. So effective, for example, this date, there was changed to the general notes here. Let's see if there is any change to chapter notes and section notes. Yeah, there is some. So you have a change to chapter A98. You have a change to in chapter 99. Chapter 26 statistical note changed. So not too many this time, but this is a place where you go look to make sure that you are doing your HTS book is up to date. Now, so two or more headings is a requirement. Now, what is the heading? All right. So the heading we already learned that the heading is really the first four digits of the harmonized tariff schedule number, and you may get a hint of the possibility of GRI 3 because customs examiners in the answer choice may provide you with various numbers, which may imply that you have to, such as here, for example. See, so this is one of the questions from the customs broker exam. And you can see customs examiners give you one heading another heading, and another heading. So in this one question, you really have four different headings to choose from. Is a GRI 3 question or GRI 1? Well, as you know, the devil is in the details, but again, this is an example of a possibility of multiple headings being there, and therefore GRI 3 being applicable. Here is another one. Also a question from the past examination. What is the correct classification of baseball, of leather baseball batting gloves? And custom examiners give you five different answer choices. So they in the fact pattern, we know they're made out of leather. They're used in baseball, which is sports, right? And they're used specifically for batting.